Welcome to Village Church. We're committed to seeing people transformed into fully devoted followers of Jesus. We do this through focusing on gospel, community, and culture. Learn more about us at thisisvillagechurch.com.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Good to be here. Like we said, my name is Victor. I'm part of the preaching team, pastor here at Village Church, and it's so good to be with you this morning. As you may know, that maybe if you're new, you maybe haven't heard, we are in a series called The Gospel of John, and it has been a long but enjoyable haul. We are in the last chapter here. We are in the last little bit, and we're so excited to finish off. This won't be the last sermon, but next week will be the last sermon, and it has been such a joy to go through this book together. In fact, you think about it, we started this series right in the heart of this pandemic, and it's been really an anchor point to think about. So much change has happened, especially as a church and a community. We've had leadership change. We've had to figure our church through a pandemic. And this has been an anchor point to lean into the teachings of Jesus and discover and to be encouraged and be challenged and to, in the midst of so much change and disruption, to actually have a place where we can go and actually be solidified as a community and learn and glean from this book, the Gospel of John. So I'm so excited to continue on in this series together. This last chapter in chapter 21, it kind of ends on a bit of a somber note. There's this real strong push towards mission, the mission of Jesus and what he invites all of us to. And we see that in a conversation that he has with Peter. John's doing something kind of interesting. He's been spending the whole book explaining and defending and articulating who Jesus is, his ministry, his life, what he's proclaiming, his teachings, his godship, his connection to the Father and the Spirit, all these beautiful things to show really who Jesus is to us. And chapter 21 is really our response to that through the mission that Jesus invites us into. I don't know if you guys have ever used virtual reality before. VR, you know, like video games have evolved and there's those things now with the goggles. Usually you get a set of batons and you're playing different things. Maybe you're playing I had a chance to play it for the first time and it was so immersive. Like I've played video games in the past and this thing is just, it's almost scary how immersive it is. It is a different reality. It is a different world that you jump into. And you can play golf, you can tennis, you can do like this roller coaster thing. There's even this one where you can shoot bad guys and you gotta dodge and there's like bullets coming your way. You're gonna do Matrix and all that stuff. And so usually you need like maybe 4 feet radius so you don't bonk someone. You can't see what's around you. And so I get a chance to play this thing. And so I'm using the batons and I'm playing golf and I'm shooting bad guys and all that stuff. And then my friend, Alicia Chinchilla, gets a chance to play it. And she's just a different person. We have to clear all the furniture in the living room for her to play. She is doing high kicks. She's like, she doesn't even know what, you're just getting out of the way of her. At one point, she's shooting bad guys. She's on the ground. She's like lying on the ground shooting bad guys. I don't know if she's having a seizure or if like, do you need help? Are you okay? And she's like, no, I'm in it. I'm in the zone. And I'm like, okay, I'm just gonna leave you be. And she didn't end the game because she got tired. She ends the game because she dives into a coffee table and a lamp and into the corner of the room and gets taken out. Like she literally believed her life was in danger. These two realities of what is happening in this game and actually knowing what's happening in real life. When something is true and real, we know a reality. We know it's just a video game, but it seems like the circumstances are quite different. And I think we, as a church, or if you're new to this, are exploring Christianity. When you think about what Jesus calls us into, sometimes those feel quite different as well. Something that, if you've read the New Testament or familiar with Scripture, what seems such a prominent theme all throughout Scripture, this idea of Jesus' mission, what he's inviting us into as a church, to be ambassadors of reconciliation, to proclaim the gospel, to make disciples, to be pushing love, goodness, faithfulness of Jesus forward, to represent that in our communities, to be incarnational in our neighborhoods, all the stuff that echoes the mission of Jesus. We see it all over Scripture. And yet, if we're really honest and transparent in this room, for many of us, it doesn't make the top of the list. In fact, it makes its way probably down the bottom, and for some of us, right at the very bottom of priorities. And we look at Peter's life, and we find ourselves in some of those doubts and challenges that Peter faced. Chapter 21, verse 1 opens up this way. It says, after this, Jesus revealed himself again to his disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he revealed himself in this way. So Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the son of Zebedee, and the two other disciples were together. So Simon and a bunch of disciples. Simon Peter said to them, I'm going fishing. They said to him, we'll go with you. Then they went out of the boat, but that night they caught nothing. This is wild. What a weird way to end a book. Like, these guys have seen literally Jesus walk through a wall not only a week ago, the resurrected Jesus. They spent 3 years seeing Jesus' miracles, doing ministry alongside him, them even healing people through the power of Jesus. Peter himself, the guy in the fishing boat, literally proclaims, Jesus, you are God, in front of all the disciples not long ago. And here we find Peter not knowing what to do and just going out in a fishing boat with a bunch of disciples. It's a weird turn. And scholars debate what's actually happening here. And some go as far as he's just like, he's given up on this whole thing. He's going back to his old lifestyle of fisherman, trying to just make money. And other scholars would say, no, he's actually anticipating Jesus. He's excited for Jesus to come back. And then he just needed to feed himself. So he went and did what he knows best and goes fishing. I think the truth is probably somewhere in the middle. Like, you pull back, this whole book climax is not with empowered saints, believers of Jesus, going out and doing radical mission. No, uncertain and waiting disciples jumping into a fishing boat. That's the story we're given. And you imagine being in that boat, the conversation that these guys might have had, having no idea when Jesus would return or not sure when he would come back, if he would at all, just not knowing, questioning the mission they got invited to. Is this thing even work? What's the future of this? Where is this going? And Peter of all people, the last encounter he had with Jesus was denying him 3 times while he's being beaten up in a false trial. They didn't wrap that up. They haven't really seen each other since. Peter's probably questioning, am I like forgotten? Am I denied? Will Jesus ever want to talk to me again? You can imagine the doubts going through these guys' minds. Similar doubts might perhaps go through your mind at times of questioning, does this mission that we've been invited to, does it even work? If we can be honest with ourselves and the questions that you have. We had a production meeting. We have a production meeting side stage here every week. And a couple weeks ago, we were praying, because our month of prayer, we're praying for those who don't know Jesus, friends, coworkers, family members. And we kind of like, let's set aside the service for a second. Let's just, it's 10 minutes before service starts, but let's just, as a community, as a team, let's pray by name those who don't know Jesus. And it was heavy. Like the moment where there's people are speaking out, people by name, friends they've been praying for so long, family members, kids who gave up on their faith a long time ago. You could feel the weight in the room. And in full transparency, for me personally, my wife and I, when we drop off Jackson, our son, at school, there's a chance to hang out with a couple parents and linger. And for us, it's a great chance to connect and get to know people in the neighborhood. And there's one in particular that we've been kind of invested in. We've invited him into our home, and we've wanted to hear his story. And we had a chance to actually share ours and what we believe. And hey, just explaining who Jesus is and why we go to church. And stonewalled. Yeah, I've been to church before. That's not my thing. I've been burnt. I've been hurt by leaders. I'll never go back. I'll never fall for that stuff again. And it just feeling like we're not making any more progress in the conversation. You question at times, does this thing even work? Is Jesus involved in this? Does the mission work? Maybe you can relate to the disciples sitting in the boat questioning what Jesus is up to. But then we see in verse 4, Jesus doesn't leave Peter in that place. It says verse 4, just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore. Yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, children, do you have any fish? I imagine their answer. They answered, no. He said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat and you will find some. So they cast it. And now they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved therefore said to Peter, it is the Lord. So much more is happening here than just Jesus hooking him up with a whole bunch of fish they don't even know what to do with. No. Jesus is pulling Peter and triggering this transformative memory that Peter, remember, don't you remember even how you and I met when I called you out and said, follow me? When you were a fisherman in this exact same situation in John 1, the beginning of this book, I called you out and said, you'd be a fisher of men. Look around you, Peter. Look at all the fish in your boat. Look at all the fish you don't even have to do with. I'm calling you out back to what I called you to be, the destiny, the purpose, the calling that I had on you. See, for Peter, everything changed. He denied Jesus 3 times. He went back to fishing, but for Jesus, nothing changed. He didn't disqualify him from his past mistakes and failures. No, he pulled back the calling that he's always called him to be, a fisher of men. Remember, Peter. Often Jesus sees so much in ourselves that we don't even see in ourselves. And to remember where you came from, to remember your beginnings, when you met Jesus and everything changed for you, how he's been so faithful to you in the past. You want to talk about faithfulness? So I had this strong call towards ministry when I was like 18, 19 years old. And I loved youth ministry. I just wanted to spend time with teenagers all the time. And so I had this opportunity at one of the churches, the church before this one, to actually come on staff as the youth pastor, which was probably a terrible mistake because I remember writing my first sermon ever. So part of youth ministry, you got to preach, right? So I write my first sermon ever, and I'm thinking, this is easy. I'm writing stuff down. I'm like, this is gold. Like, I'm going to transform these kids. I'm going to blow their minds with all this content. It's so good. I don't know what people are complaining about. Preaching is so easy. And then I go up and do it, and it's so bad. Like, it's so bad. You think, yeah, it can't be. No, it's bad. It's really bad. Like, I think I left those people, those kids, worse off than when they started. I actually, just out of like for humility and my own like remembering how faithful Jesus is to me, I have that first sermon recording. And if you want, I could actually share a little bit of it right now. I have like a 15-second clip. It's so bad. And it's okay to laugh. I moved on. I'm healed. You can laugh at it. It's so bad. Okay, so let's play that clip if we have it.
It says, be kind and compassionate for one another, forgiving each other just as Christ God forgave you, or forgiving each other, just Christ God forgave you. So it's pretty straightforward. It's pretty serious. This isn't like a recommendation. This isn't, I'd like you to do this. This is God saying you need to do this. Like, you need to forgive as I forgave you. And so as we live in this fallen world, we have to deal with this daily.
Yeah. Yeah, that's bad. It's so bad. And I have that to remind myself of how faithful God is to me. And in all seriousness, though, like that 19-year-old guy who's fumbling through his words and maybe haven't changed that much, maybe I'm still there. But just how God was so faithful to that 19-year-old kid who's just figuring out life and ministry, and how faithful he is to you, no matter what you're going through, that he can literally use anyone at any time for his glory and for his mission. And he's calling us, like he did with Peter, to remember those moments. Remember where you came from. Remember what I've done with you. We have people here at Village Church who their past, one of them used to be trafficking drugs. The other one would be massively addicted to drugs. And now is like healed and doing ministry, serving alongside each other. The user and the dealer now advancing the kingdom forward here at Village Church. Like there are people here that I just met with recently, guys who, one of the guys who's just like, he had a past of like, he had no purpose, he had no direction, he would just go to the pub almost every night and just get drunk with his friends, and he'd wake up with just hangovers, he just kind of, the day was a wash after that, and now he's been baptized, he's serving like a prominent role here at Village, and like invigorated with direction, moving the mission of Jesus forward. Like I think about my own life. Like I think about my past when I was like 18 years old. I remember being in a New Year's. I remember just like all throughout high school, all through my teenage years, growing up in the, you know, Christian family. That was my context. But I just couldn't get this thing started. I couldn't maybe relate to, I couldn't like just, I tried everything to like fall in love with Jesus. It was just like trying to turn over a car in like a cold morning. It wouldn't go. It wouldn't work. And I remember at a point where I just kind of gave up on the thing. I'm just like, I just feel like this isn't working for me. And I remember being absolutely drunk at a New Year's Eve party. My buddy, he's driving me home. My head's like hanging out the window, trying not to vomit. And he's telling me about this missions program that I should jump and get involved in called YWAM. And something, and whatever didn't work in the past and in my own strength, trying to get this thing going, just I sobered up in a second, just like, yes, I'm jumping on board with that. I've never looked back since. There's these moments where God transforms everything you are, to remember those moments. And when Jesus questions the disciples saying, hey, do you have any fish in there? He's not saying, hey, you guys suck at fishing. That's not what he's trying to get at. He's saying, hey, you realize you can't do any of this without me, right? Like alcoholics, people who are addicted to drugs, trafficking drugs, people simply just disinterested in this whole thing like myself, can't save themselves. And you can't save them either. It's like literally, it's trying to fish and you're not catching anything. But when Jesus shows up and steps into the story, everything changes. You have more fish, you know what to do with. He transforms anyone. And as you heard, and for those who are at the Surrey locations, we've been doing Alpha for quite some time, especially in prison ministry. Like the access we have to this local prison is insane. The favor and the fruitfulness is happening. There's 18 units, about 20 guys per unit. We have access to 3 units. And that's like a miracle we even got that. Like it's been so good to kind of like lean in and strategize how to get access to these things. But we've been doing alphas. I mean, so much fruit that recently, this last week, they just love what we're doing. They're seeing the fruit of it. They're like, you can have all 18 units. Go nuts. And like literally up to like worst case gang affiliated murders, that unit, that's ours. Like we are literally taking over that prison. They're saying, you want to do like services or events? We usually don't do this. Go at it. And so we're just like, the whole prison's ours. And so it's this beautiful thing. And the reason is because we're seeing Alpha, guys who want nothing to do with Jesus are making fun of the whole Alpha experience. One of the guys is a Satanist who has literally upside down tattoos on his face. By the end of Alpha, he's tearing down symbols in his cell, demonic symbols, and setting up scripture in his cell. Like we're seeing fruit happen. And it's nothing that these Alpha volunteers are doing. They're not winsome. They're not like clever in how to win these people. It's not even the Alpha videos themselves. They're well curated or engaging videos. These are all literally fishermen catching nothing. But when Jesus shows up to people who are willing to serve and be on mission, things change. There's more fish in the boat than you need to do with. And when you think about your life, those who are maybe praying side stage and are here right now, or maybe you've been struggling with me. I have a son or daughter who's been praying and just I don't know what to do with, or it's like a friend, I just feel like I'm not getting traction. Whatever the thing might be, remember this story that Jesus showed up after a whole night of catching nothing. The 11th hour when he shows up. And when the disciples, he says to the disciples, hey, like, throw it on the right side. The disciples aren't like, oh, wow, the 548th time, this is gonna be it. No, they're being polite and trying to be dismissive with zero expectation of anything happening. And so whether your heart is full of faith, excited, expecting God to move, or you are exhausted from years of praying with such little faith that God would do anything, he moves, he works, he does things. It's who he is. And so be encouraged, and maybe for some of you, it's not really this. You've heard the stories, you've heard the Alpha story, you're excited, you think the mission works. But the reason mission for you is maybe not at the top of the list of priority is because you're actually convinced that you don't work, that your contribution to mission is nothing. Let's move down to verse 15. So after they had a meal together, they're at the shore now, and Jesus pulls Peter aside privately and has a conversation. It's a familiar one for those who've been in the church for a long time. Verse 15, it says, when they finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." He said to him a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." He said, "Tend to my sheep." He said to him a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." It's a fascinating conversation. It's important to realize that Jesus may not disqualify you for past mistakes, but in no way is he overlooking those mistakes. I bought an exercise machine recently. I know it's like a classic pastor thing to do, but it's like when you're behind like emails all day and meetings all day, and you're going out and having coffee with people from the church and like with sugary lattes, it's like you just don't stay healthy unless you're intentional. So I bought this kind of New Year's resolution idea. I bought this exercise machine. My son, Jackson, who's 6 years old, just likes to jump on it and play on it. It's kind of like new for me. So I'm like, hey, this is kind of my thing, like dad only, like hands off. And I remember being a little bit firm with him. And he goes upstairs angry at me. And I'm like, oh, okay, maybe I should follow him and apologize, whatever, to my six-year-old son. And so I go up there and I'm like, hey man, like, and I was about to apologize. See, he has like this board and he's been writing on it. It's like a score card. And he has everyone's name on it. Like my wife, mine, like his siblings, Denver and London. And I have 2 marks on it. And Kristen had like 13, but. And I'm like, what's that? What is that? He's like, oh yeah, when you've wronged me, I don't know if that was the language you used, but you've sinned against me, then I strike a mark. And so I'm like, well, hey, no, like, I'm apologizing. I'm like, hey, I feel like I was a bit rough with you, and so I'm sorry, and so we can get rid of that, right? And I was, oddly, this thing had way too much power over me. And I remember even like sharing the gospel. He's like, you know what Jesus does? Like he, all the things we do, he like tears that thing up, the scorecard, and he doesn't hold that against us. And so, you know, you should tear it up. And he doesn't. So I'm like, man, this self-righteous little kid. It's okay. We're working on him. But there's something between me and him in that moment. In the same way, Peter has done something that sits heavy between Jesus and him and needs to be addressed before moving Peter into anything like feed my lamb, feed my sheep, any of that. That idea of like build my church, lead this thing, go and make disciples, proclaim the gospel, hold up. Let's get to something here. We know earlier in the story that if you're familiar with it, where Jesus is saying, hey, I'm going to die soon, and you guys are going to all scatter, and Peter in his arrogance say, not me. They might, but I will stick with you right to the end. And if you know the story, we know Peter denies. He denies Jesus 3 times. In this moment where he's going on a walk with Jesus, there's intense shame and guilt residing in Peter, and Jesus goes after it. In short, this conversation, this repeated conversation is, hey, Peter, you failed me. And Peter's response, I know. No, Peter, you failed me. I know. Peter, you failed me. I know. It's like, wow, this seems ruthless. Like, the guy already feels bad. Can't you just leave it be? It feels like he's twisting the knife even further. Exactly. But it's the knife of a great surgeon. Why? Like, why uproot all this stuff? Why uproot? Can't you just leave the past be the past? Can we just move forward like we always do in our relationship? Just not talk about it and move on quick? No, that's not the most loving thing to do, because Peter would go on traveling and proclaim the gospel and making disciples, knowing, always haunted with the feeling of being an imposter, that he denied Jesus. Always a sense that people can't find out. They can't know. I got to bury the past, preaching to crowds. Is there someone in the crowd that knows what I did, that I denied? Peter, that's not a person that's healed from Jesus. It's the same way in the woman at the well. If you're familiar with that story in the Gospels, this woman who meets Jesus at the well has a bad resume. Not a great resume. It has been used and abused by multiple men. It has multiple husbands, kind of been passed around, and the man she's with right now is not even her husband. She has this beautiful conversation with Jesus. They talk theology for a bit, but for her to find freedom, Jesus has to go there. He asks her, hey, why don't you grab your husband? We can continue this conversation. She says, I don't have a husband. He's like, I know, you have five, and the man you're sleeping with isn't your husband. It's like, man, why you gotta go there? Why you gotta do that? Why you gotta bring that up? Can't you just leave it be? Can't we just have a nice conversation? Because they're gonna have a great conversation. She's gonna realize he's the Messiah, and she's gonna go back excited to tell people, and the thing that'll overshadow that encounter is this gnawing guilt and shame of who she knows she is, an imposter undeserving of Jesus' love and acceptance. But just like Peter, when you go to the deepest parts of your life, the ugliest things that you want to take to the grave and not tell anyone, the failures of your past, when you actually go there with Jesus and you turn around expecting him to be gone, he's still there. And you go deeper. Deeper. He's like, yeah, let's go deeper with the great surgeon's life. Let's go deeper to that hurt and pain. And you're expecting it to abandon you. And you turn around, you see Jesus fully accepting of who you are. That does something to you. Shame and guilt have no power. That fear of being cast out, not accepted, not loved. You find a Savior who fully embraces and loves you in the darkest, guiltiest failure of your life. That's who he is. And like, if you put your past, if you put my past mistakes up on this screen in front of the whole church, like you have a picture of me hanging out the window of a car, trying not to vomit, drunk out of my mind, would that be embarrassing? Absolutely. Would it be shameful? No, because I'm accepted in Jesus in all, everything that I am, everything that I've done, he accepts me. I don't have to wear shame anymore. There's no fear of being cast out by him. And here's the thing. I think some of us, this is my worry, is that we cognitively understand forgiveness. We know in our heads, we understand that our slates are clean, that he doesn't hold that against us anymore. We're good with the Father. All the theological bits and pieces, we get it. But there's still this weight of shame and guilt that haunts us, that we're not free from. It's just an idea you understand, but not a reality that is lived out. You still walk around wearing this, heavy. I hope that no one finds out what I have done. And my worry is that if your stuff was up on this screen, that you would never show your face up here again. The church, of all places, this community, if we can't be an environment for that, stop giving, stop serving. These things we're excited about, building campaigns and new leaders and vision, all stuff, church planted across Canada. It's like, don't bother if we can't create environments for people to come as they are with all the good, the bad, the ugly, and have a safe environment to actually work through that stuff with Jesus in community. If we can't cultivate that, then let's clean up shop and move on. That's what it has to be about. Like, my worry is that we miss it. We miss that we're carrying this weight of guilt and shame. And when Romans 8:1 says there's actually no condemnation in Jesus Christ. There's none. There's no shame and guilt in who he is. It's one of the most essential things of what he offers you in the gospel, that he removes and he heals this from you. What he gave to Peter and he worked with the woman, it is one of the most essential things that we then in mission can offer the world. Look at my life. Poke and prod all you want. Yeah, that's my past. This is embarrassing. I'm not gonna be defensive. I'm not gonna be ashamed of it. Because Jesus actually has accepted me for who I am. That's a powerful thing we can offer the world. And if we're living the shadow of our guilt and shame, jumping on mission, what exactly are we offering the world? What power is in the gospel that we have on offer? Jesus wants to set people on mission who the world or their past have no power over them, and because they're fully accepted in Jesus. People who are allowed the great surgeon to cut the ugliest cancerous parts of their soul, and in turn, producing a greater love than ever we could imagine. Like that Luke 7 kind of idea where it says, therefore I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much.
But he who is forgiven little loves little. What Tim Keller says, plunge your failure into his grace. It'll make you greater than you ever were before. A greater failure plunged into his grace makes a greater disciple. Like when you plunge deep into your sin with Jesus, you turn around, you see grace abounds. You go deeper and more grace. There's just always more grace there. That's how he works. That's the good news on offer to us. It changes everything. There's a story of an assistant to a pastor that walks into his office and he finds him passed out drunk on the desk. It's not like a Monday morning you're looking forward to. It wasn't a village, don't worry. But he does what he should do. He phones the elders right away. He's like, whoa, this just happened. What do we do? They had like a great course of action. It was really healthy. They acted quickly. They were transparent with the church, everything that happened. They brought this pastor into counseling. And the intention, the plan was to move him to termination of his employment and find a new pastor in that role. Not wrong to do that. There's above reproach a call for pastors. But This other pastor, a seasoned pastor, who's like a consultant, comes into the conversation like, let me just try a different pathway here that I could just introduce to you guys. And he says, what if instead we did that? Yes, counseling, all this beautiful stuff. We actually get him out of ministry. We just allow him to be in the community of the church, no expectations for an extended period of time. We have good people around him discerning when potentially he could actually even step back into ministry. And he could be, you know, slowly at the right time, as long as it takes to feel like it's the right time to do this, start integrating him into ministry for his love and his passion for ministry. And at the end of the story, this guy is thriving as a pastor at a different church where his community knows his full story. And there's no shame and guilt. All his past, all his wounds, all his scars, and he's loving the call that he's been given. He's loving serving that community, that Luke 7 idea. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. And what if actually some of our best leaders could come out of their deepest failures? Do we make space for that? Do we make opportunity for that? Is there room for redemption these days? Like we push justice hard, and that's awesome. We need to be people of justice more than we even are right now. I love that. It's beautiful. It resides in the heart of Jesus in every way. But I don't hear many stories of redemption and reconciliation these days. I think we're naturally suspicious of second chances. I feel our modern day gospel would speak to Peter and say, you deny Jesus 3 times, you're done. Move on. But what if we were not only champions of justice, but advocates for redemption? Peter, who denied Jesus 3 times, in turn being the greatest, one of the greatest pastors in all of history. What if you had those kind of stories? And what about you? What about you? You think you don't work? And maybe you're right. You've already disqualified yourself. You've done too many things. Currently, maybe from right now, you're sitting in your deepest failure, questioning if there's any future. So plunge yourself. Plunge yourself in his grace and find complete acceptance in him, the only place where shame and guilt can actually be put to death. What if in the darkest pit of what you're going through, your greatest failure is a launching pad into greatness with him, redeemed in the greater love, redeemed into greater mercy, jumping into incredible mission with Jesus? What if your best years are ahead of you? What if he is not done with you? I don't work. You're in good company. You're right, but he does. That's who he is. You bring all the good, the bad, the ugly to him. He heals it. He uses it for his glory. And to end, there's this fascinating chunk that we overlooked in this text. Where is this all this moving? Where is this all this going? This idea of mission onto what? Where is the end point? What are we giving ourselves to? It feels like John, this book, is ending kind of on a flat note, if we're honest. It's a bunch of dudes getting in a fishing boat, and Peter has a conversation with Jesus, and then it's done. It's kind of odd, but we actually get this climactic picture that the whole Bible points to just before Peter speaks with Jesus. In verse 9, it says, when they got on the land, they saw a charcoal fire in place with fish laid out on it and bread. Jesus said to them, bring some of this fish that you have just caught. So Peter, went abroad hauling all the nets ashore full of fish, 153 of them, if you're curious. And although there were so many, the net was not torn. Catch this, Jesus said to them, come, have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared ask, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. This is the image we get. Here's the picture. It's a bunch of fishermen reinvigorated with hope that Jesus is doing something, that he's on mission again. They're squatting around a small fire. Maybe they're rolling a couple stones to get comfortable to sit on around this small little fire, pulling out the spine of overcooked, charred fish, ripping apart the fish and passing around with their soaking wet, weathered hands. This is the picture of followers sharing bread and fish with their resurrected rabbi. It would have been a common scene for any passerby or just a bunch of fishermen eating fish is our greatest hope. That image, a picture of redeemed people eating with God. Much like that we get in Revelation 19, the end, the celebration of God's people and God eating together after he's made all things new. This image teases that out. Men who were buried in their sin, enemies of God, resisting him, and now sitting around a fire, redeemed, forgiven, no shame, no guilt, enjoying his company. This is why we're on mission. The call is to invite as many people around the fire pit as we can. To invite as many people to enjoy God for eternity. That's the call. So let's pray. Father, thank you for this, almost this quiet before the storm. We saw all through the Gospel of John, you doing incredible miracles, speaking and teaching, shaking things up. And it's this quiet before the storm before you have explosive launch of the church in Acts. Help us lean into this quiet moment of even doing work in ourselves, of why maybe we struggle to believe the mission even works, why we struggle to believe that we can actually contribute nothing to it. Lord, I pray in this moment you would speak to that. What you did in Peter's life, how you reinvigorated these disciples, how you set them on the course of incredible mission that would be known and ring throughout the rest of history. Lord, you can do incredible things for those in our lives, for those who are just tired, exhausted of praying the same thing over and over again, for their kids, for their family members, for parents. Lord, reinvigorate them with hope and faith again. For those who are sitting in their greatest failure right now, it doesn't get darker than this. But they would know that you were right there in the pit with them, fully accepting, fully embracing of grace and love, that they'd be their greatest launch pad out of shame and guilt and failure into the mission of Jesus with you. Lord, I'm grateful that you don't leave us sitting in it. You don't leave us. You don't just, let's not talk about that. Let's not, no, you go there. You go there with all of us. So for those who just need the great surgeon to do that type of work, even today in this moment as a response, I pray you do that knowing that the knife is with gentleness, it's with compassion, and it's with love. We pray all this in your beautiful name. Amen.